Well, they didn't know they needed it. Okay, so let's just finish. So we don't, did we talk about Grant's two-prong approach?
No.
Grant has two main ideas. Number one, attack south. Go south from Tennessee is up here, and then the Georgia's right here. Atlanta is here. He sends Sherman to Tennessee, from Tennessee to Georgia, and they laid siege to Atlanta. Atlanta was heavily fortified also. It took months for them to finally conquer Atlanta. And then from Atlanta, here's the ocean. From Atlanta, 60 mile wide, this path of destruction like this, and then he goes north. And basically, everything of value, we talked about this. We're good. We're okay right now. Thank you. Thank you. I forgot. Are we on? 60 mile wide swath of destruction. Anything of value, anything that could support the war effort. Food they couldn't take with them. They destroyed it so the people couldn't use it. Houses burned, crops burned, railroads destroyed. Cotton burned, anything of value was destroyed so that they could not resist. It's like total war is a concept here. Yeah.
So Grant was the commander and he got to pick up the leaders, so Sherman was the guy who
Sherman and Grant had known each other earlier. They had kept in contact as Shiloh. Grant and Sherman were together fighting, you know, at the Battle of Shiloh in 1862, in the beginning of the war. They're very closely connected. They both understand how to win. It's to be ruthless and not worry about the casualties. You just send them in. The same idea Lincoln will have. Send them in. Destroy the Confederate Army. That's how you win. And he, of course, does it. The second part of this is attack due south from Washington. You got to get Richmond, and that's where Lee is, and destroy his army. And remember how McClellan will have, he'll only have one battle, and then he'll wait, and he'll have a month later, he'll have another battle. Look at what Grant's doing in 64. Did we do this yesterday?
No.
Look at, so May 5th, the Battle of Wilderness, another one of these terrible, terrible battles. 55,000 casualties, right? 2 days later, or what, not even 2 days, the next battles right after it, May 8th, we get another 18,000 casualties. So that's 50, 60, 70,000 casualties in 5 days. 70,000 casualties in 5 days. And then you get another 12,000, if you can see this, look at this. Another 12,000 at Cold Harbor. That's within a month. So that we have 70, 80,000 casualties in a month. Do you recognize that's a lot? You know, we had 10 years of war with Iraq and Afghanistan where we had we probably had 10,000 casualties, 5,000 killed, probably at least 10 to 20,000 casualties, like wounded. That's in 10 years. This is in 1 month. Can you see the numbers? Can you see why people are going, I don't know if Lincoln's doing a good job. 80,000 casualties. Yeah, that's pretty dang stark. 7,000 in 20 minutes. Why do you think Cold Harbor? That was a really bad one. Why do you think?
That little
fortifications. You're massing, you're charging a fortified position, and you get blasted. And that's... We reenact that one in this. Anyway, it's a night battle. It's really kind of neat. I'll show it to you when you get a chance. But right now, we gotta kill Lincoln first. Okay. September to December is Sherman's march to the sea. That's gonna make, again, why is Atlanta important? It helps Lincoln get reelected, right? Because with Atlanta falling, in September, basically people say, oh, the war is coming to an end. The war will come to an end soon. That's the indication. It's a major city. It's in the heart of the Confederacy. It's just a matter of time now. That saves Lincoln's reelection. Sherman's march to the sea. Did we read this already? Can somebody read that for me?
I'll read it.
Where are you going?
I love to enter your classroom.
First of all, don't ever walk in front of me in the middle of my class and throw something away. Second, put it in your backpack if you have trash. Third, read this.
We cannot change the hearts of those people of the South, but we can make war so terrible and make them so sick of war that generations would pass away before they would again appeal to it.
What's it mean? What's the reference?
Like, you want...
Who's speaking?
Sherman.
Right, you got to make the connection. This is a quote from Sherman about making war terrible for the Southerners. What does it relate to? Sherman's march to the sea. That's right. So you connect it, because remember the massive destruction that he imposes on Georgia. It's a big deal. They still hate Sherman today. I mean, Georgia's not such a great place. Anyway. Anyways. Here's William Tecumseh Sherman. You remember his middle name? The Indian. The Indian, one of the twins, right? Who? Yeah, he's on your test. You start reviewing. So his dad was from Ohio and recognized and respected Tecumseh. And he was known by his middle name most of the time. That's what he went by. His family called him Kumpy. Kumpy. You know why? Kumpy. Get it? Isn't that funny? Read a great biography about Sherman last summer, and he's a totally interesting dude. Very rich family. He was a ginger. We've learned about two gingers in this class so far. Who are they?
Sherman.
And
Kumpy. I don't think
he's ginger. You can't tell from this, but he is.
I don't think you could tell anybody's ginger.
It's like white.
Yes.
No, Lincoln was a brunette. No, Washington was a ginger.
What?
No. George Washington was a ginger.
He had gray hair.
He had white hair.
Oh, white
hair. See those pictures of
Lincoln?
Wait,
he was? Washington was a ginger?
How do you know?
I'm
going to
look
for
it.
Can I look it up?
I don't believe it.
Yeah,
I don't believe it.
McClellan runs on the election of 64. He was very, Lincoln was very unpopular. Lincoln thought he was going to lose. He was so convinced he was going to lose, he wrote a resignation speech saying, I lost the election, etc. Yeah.
George Washington wore his own hair, which was light brown in color.
No, it's ginger. Where'd you get that from? From the internet? Oh, that's trustworthy.
Look at that.
Which president had red hair? Oh, it says which president had red hair? Thomas Jefferson, Andrew Jackson, Martin Van Buren, Rutherford B. Hayes, Calvin Coolidge,
accurate.
And Jimmy Carter, and John F. Kennedy. That's who they
John Kennedy definitely
did not have a chin. Excuse me. Sorry. Sorry. Stop. Stop it. Stop. Stop. Okay, 5 minutes. Is there being bad? Okay. McClellan was a copperhead. He was an anti-war Democrat. He runs against Lincoln.
Get it, copperhead. Sorry.
Learn it yourself. Moving on. Okay. just learn it yourself. You don't need me for that. We did? We did. Went over this?
Oh, there's Lincoln's shot.
Not all of it.
Okay. Do you just want to do it on your own?
No.
Okay, can I finish?
Yeah.
Okay, so a couple of basic things. The Freedmen's Bureau, the war, 1865 March, the war is almost over. It's going to stop end April 9th at a place called Appomattox Courthouse. Everyone say Appomattox.
Appomattox.
It's where Lee surrenders to Grant. Lee's army is exhausted. They could fight more, but it is futile. The resources that are against them are just so massive. So Lee just says, I don't want to have any more suffering from my men, and he surrenders. We get really positive terms from Grant. Grant is not like, you know, get over it, you lost, you know, like people are today. He's very magnanimous, he's very understanding. He said officers could keep their sidearms and their horses, etc. So it was a very somber, sullen occasion.
Grant was okay with all this? He was nice?
Grant was very magnanimous. He didn't, you know, wasn't hostile towards the Confederates who were surrendering. He had favorable terms. It was like, okay, you lost, so go back home. Yeah. Fun fact, they had to take an oath of allegiance. They were supposed to take an oath of allegiance to the Union for a pardon. You get a pardon for any crimes. With your oath of allegiance, you are pardoned for your treason. Get it? Treason is a capital offense. All of the Confederate leaders would easily be convicted of treason. Lincoln did not want that. There's only one person executed at the end of the Civil War for war crimes, and it was this guy named Henry Wirz, W-I-R-Z. He was in charge of Andersonville Prison, which is a wonderful place you all should visit. I'll show you some.
Yeah.
There's a whole movie on it.
Show us a clip.
Can we finish this? Yeah, we can't. But I might show you a clip. This is a prison where you had, it was only supposed to hold like 5,000, then they had 50,000 Union prisoners in it. And you probably had 20,000 died of disease and starvation. And so that commandant to that prison, Andersonville, it's deep into southern Georgia, he was put on trial and was executed. He was basically a scapegoat. Jefferson Davis is held in prison for a short time and then released. Lee, I don't think, ever goes to prison. The generals don't go to prison. It's very lenient on these rebels, right? So April 9th, the war is over, Appomattox Courthouse. And then April 14th, John Wilkes Booth shoots Abraham Lincoln in the head while he's watching a play in Washington, D.C. So we got, 5 days after the end of the war, Lincoln is dead. That's a big shock for the country. They're celebrating, and then all of a sudden, their captain, right? What's his name? Whitman's poem, Captain, My Captain, he's dead. And there's mourning all through the North. Even though he wasn't as popular, he really gets more popular when he dies. John Wilkes Booth is a Southern sympathizer. There was a great special last night on TV, on PBS, it's called American Experience, John Wilkes Booth. The fun story about this is it was not just Lincoln thereafter. They were trying to kill Seward and Johnson and Stanton, the whole executive cabinet they were going to kill. But they wound Seward. They almost kill Seward. The only one they really get is Lincoln. Yeah.
Did they stab Seward?
Recently? That's right. They stab him in the face. He almost dies. He stabbed his son. He almost dies. But they capture them all. They put them on trial. And they execute them all. Hanging. There's a great picture in here if you want to see a picture of him.
I thought John Wilkes Booth like died in a fire.
He's shot. John Wilkes Booth is shot. He's hiding. He gets away from Washington. He's going south.
Didn't he like break his ankle? And
he broke his leg when he jumped off the balcony after he shot Lincoln. He flees Washington, D.C. He goes south, and then they surround where he was hiding. They put him. He was in a barn. They start the barn on fire to force him to come out, and they shoot him when he comes out. So he's killed immediately. But they have a big trial. A woman, the mother of one of the conspirators, they held the meetings in her boarding house, and they blamed her also, and they hang her. Ooh. Mrs. Surratt is her name. Mary Surratt, I think. Anyway, the new president is a guy named Andrew Johnson. Andrew Johnson is a Democrat. Andrew Johnson is a Democrat. And this relates to Reconstruction. It's very important. Johnson is from Tennessee. He's a Southerner. He's a white supremacist. He doesn't like the South. He doesn't like the Southern elite leaders in the South. Wake up now. You look like you're on vacation. Sit up. Take that thing off your ear. Put a pencil or pen in your hand. Yeah, use his because he's not using it either. He's on vacation too. Bad. That's right. Not everybody needs to pass. All right, moving on. What's his name? Andrew Johnson. So, short story. The people who are running Reconstruction, the radical Reconstruction, we talked about the radical Republicans.
Yeah.
Remember the picture we showed of what was that guy? Thaddeus Stevens. Where is he? There he is. These guys are running the show after Lincoln. They hate Johnson because he's a Southerner, but they hate him even more because Johnson is not as harsh as they are. They want to punish and transform the South, right? Johnson wants to punish them a little bit. So he starts vetoing the laws that they're passing in Congress. So the radical Republicans try to get rid of Johnson. They impeach him. He does get impeached. He is voted in the House of Representatives guilty of crimes. But in the Senate, where he's on trial, he's one vote away from a two-thirds majority. Remember, it has to be a supermajority to remove the president. So he doesn't get removed, but he is impeached. Do you get it? Look for that as you're doing the reading. Good question. Okay. Very, very important. So Johnson takes over. Yes, it does. Very good. Let's see. Lincoln's second inaugural. This is most important. This is so we got the Gettysburg Address. Remember we did that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So the second most important speech, I think, or one of the most important speeches that Lincoln gives is his second inaugural. It's complicated and difficult to understand. So we need your attention and try to get it. But my voice is faltering, so I'm going to need someone to help us. You like Lincoln, don't you? Okay, can you read for us?
I'll do it.
I like to read. A woman can read Lincoln? I don't know.
What was that?
Is that possible? Okay, sorry. Yes.
You didn't hear that right. Oh, all right.
You didn't. Of course you could read Lincoln.
I think I didn't hear it right because I'm a woman. Fondly do we hope, fervently do we pray, that this mighty scourge of war may speedily pass away. Yet if God's will that it continue until all the wealth piled by the bondsman's 250 years of unrequited toil shall be sunk, and until every drop of blood drawn with the lash shall be, your thing is behind.
It's dying, I need a new battery.
Shall be paid by another drawn with the sword. As was said 3,000 years ago, so still it must be said, the judgments of the Lord are true and righteous.
Okay, this is very difficult. Thank you. So, the way you have to try to analyze this because the language is a little bit. The language is really sophisticated. Okay. And there's some metaphors and allusions that are not easy to understand. Okay. So the first part, so think of, whenever you think of documents like this, you think of messages. What message is this sending? What point of view? What is the meaning? What is the theme? Or what is the tone? Okay, think of it that way. So the first one message is the first line. We hope this war ends quickly. Got it? That's easy. And it's kind of rhymy, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Is rhymy a word? Probably not.
Poetic.
Rhymes.
Rhymy. Okay. The second part is harder. So let's see if you can get it. Ready? You got it. Okay, smarty pants, go.
It says, if it's God's will that the war continue, that they want, that let's finish this out, let's do it until the last.
Good, you're half right. So he says, yet,
that's a really long sentence.
If it's God's will. He said, maybe God, he's kind of being philosophical. He's kind of saying, well, maybe God wants this war to continue. And he has very specific details how long it will continue. And that's what's kind of hard to read here. So, go ahead.
He's transitioning the war to make it about slavery. So that.
Yes, for sure. The message is, this war is about slavery. That's for sure the underlying message. But think about the message. He says, maybe God is punishing us. Maybe God's punishing us. How is he punishing? Look, see this? He says, yet means but, if it's God's will that this war continue, how long will it continue? Until all the wealth piled by the bondsman's 250 years of unrequited toil. What's that mean? Not you. Let's get the kid who's paying attention most. How about then the kid next to you? What's her name again? Jordan. What does this line mean? Yes, but what? The money, the wealth. What's her name? Naveen, you're getting it. Maybe, he's saying, maybe God is punishing us and wants us to fight till all of the wealth created by slavery, bondsmen is slavery, unrequited toil is unpaid work. Maybe God wants us to fight until all the wealth generated by slavery is invested in the war. And that's not all. And until every drop of blood drawn with the lash, maybe all of the blood that was expended because of slavery will be invested in the war. Get it? We're paying for the, well, we are paying the price for the sin of slavery, essentially is what he's saying. In money and in blood. Maybe that's God's will. And if it's God's will, then they're true and righteous. And I guess we gotta deal with it. You understand? So he's basically saying, we are all responsible for allowing slavery, and maybe God is punishing us all. Get it? So that's one. And this part you have to memorize. This part you have to memorize. Okay? Do you want me to read it? Ready? And think of the message, think of the theme, think of the tone, you know, that is set here. With malice towards none, with charity for all, with firmness in the right as God gives us to see the right, let us strive on to finish the work we are in. To bind up the nation's wounds, to care for him who shall have borne the battle, and for his widow and his orphan, to do all which may achieve and cherish a just and lasting peace among ourselves and with all nations. Think about now words you may not know. Taylor, what's this word mean? It's okay if you don't know. Go ahead, Trevor.
It's kind of, well, maul is like
malice,
bad.
Yes.
So it's like
hatred.
Yeah.
Hatred.
Animosity.
Hatred. Malice is hatred. Don't make me kick you out. With malice, okay, repeat. With malice toward none.
With malice toward none.
She didn't do it, we gotta do it again. With malice towards none.
With malice towards none.
She didn't do it again.
Me?
Emma. No,
what?
Emma.
Yes, I did.
Your name Emma? Okay. Well, you're covering your face, I can't tell. Okay, one more time. With malice toward none.
With malice towards none.
Now Tyler didn't say it.
I said it.
Okay. All right. With charity for all.
With charity for all.
I think that's enough. So you have to remember this term. With malice toward none and charity for all.
Malice toward none.
Let us strive on to finish the work we are in, to bind up the nation's wound. Now, so what is the message here? Go ahead.
Reconstruction.
He's referencing reconstruction. Very good. What kind of reconstruction is it?
Like post-war.
Civil
leniency.
Okay, let's be clear.
The hatred.
It's a style. No hatred, right?
Yeah. So he doesn't want to. He wants to like kind of
this
form
is,
the union.
Okay.
Yeah,
so let me just.
Unify
let me just. Yes. Very good. Let me just give you the main points, okay? He's sending the message, no, we don't hate the South, and we want charity for all. Does he say only charity for the Union?
No.
No.
No. This is very lenient, very forgiving tone. It says, to bind up the nation's wounds, let's repair our divisions. Let's care for him who shall have borne the battle. Is he saying only the Yankees? Just think of what would Thaddeus Stevens say at the end of the war. Remember Thaddeus Stevens? We showed him. He'd be like, those dirty Southern rebels, we're going to punish them forever, you know. He's not saying any of that. He's saying, with malice toward none and charity for all, we will bind up the nation's wounds and take care of the people who need taken care of. And do all which may achieve and cherish a lasting peace. It's magnanimous. It's forgiving. It's one of his personality characteristics, right? And that's his plan for Reconstruction, too. This is symbolic for how he wants to treat the South, which is with malice toward none, with magnanimity, with charity, with openness and leniency. So we don't have people executed. We have a little bit of people arrested, but they eventually get out. Yeah.
So do you think Lincoln could have faced impeachment if he had not been killed?
No.
Because
he was way popular. He was so influential and so smart.
So like he would have persuaded Congress not, like, because Johnson got
He will veto not. The radical Republicans.
But wouldn't be impeached
Richard?
Because he was too
no.
popular.
No.
Is that Richard? That is Richard.
Yeah, let's see. This is Lee. This is Grant. This is some fool. Okay.
Grant takes Richard.
You like that picture?
I wonder how many other pictures have been of Richard in his photos.
I made that like 10 years ago.
Remember our brothers?
Is that your
No, I used to do a reenactment at school where we had kids dress up and do debates and stuff. We could still do it someday, but it's fun. Casualties. Okay, so just fun facts. 164,000 die from disease in the Confederates, 250,000 from the Union. Probably because there's more troops. 94,000 from wounds. 110,000 from wounds, 100,000 killed in battle, essentially, and then these guys eventually die, right? So 275, so lots of death.
Yeah.
Here's the perspective, Civil War, World War II, World War I, Vietnam. Yeah, but that's still a huge number.
Yeah.
It's massive. Meanwhile, the Republicans pass a number of bills during their administration, during the war, that are long lasting. So you got to pay attention to these for a few minutes. The first is called the Homestead Act. Homestead Act is really cool. You can get land for really cheap federal land if you go out and start a farm and develop it for at least 5 years, and then you get title for cheap prices. You can still get a homestead today. Did you know that, Colton?
Alaska, really?
In Alaska, very good. You can go to Alaska and get a homestead. I'm sure that's what you'll do. So the Homestead Act, very important. Second one, the Morrell Land Grant Act. These, by the way, always show up on the test, so just be advised. Public lands are given to the state. The states sell the land and use the money for education. So think Morrell is about education. Think about, hold on, the tariff. The Republicans will support the tariff all the way through till about 1950s. We have the tariff on the books. From 1950 to about today, the world has gone more towards globalization, no tariffs. What's happening now is with Trump, is his advocacy of economic nationalism is saying, no, we want tariffs now. And that's kind of going against the trend of, it's going against the trend of development in the 20th century. Also, lastly, the railroad gets funded. They start building it during the Civil War. Most of it is after the Civil War. There's two railroads, the Union Pacific and the Central Pacific. One going west, the other one going east. And they end up meeting in 1870s. And that's it.